Today's podcast is brought to you by FreshBooks.com. Get a 30-day free trial at GoFreshBooks.com/David Feldman Show.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Joining us is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, which raises money for progressive candidates all over America. He's also the author of the Down with Tyranny blog, Mr. Howie Klein. Hello, Howie Klein.
How are you?
Very good. Always glad to hear your voice. We're going to talk about sugar. We're going to talk about WikiLeaks. And this orange-faced guy who's running on the Republican Party. Very quickly, you made your fortune in the music industry.
I did.
Bob Dylan won a Nobel Prize. Your thoughts on Bob Dylan?
Well, Bob, you know what? They're very emotional. And I worship Bob Dylan and have since I was a kid. This I felt was sort of a recognition of, you know, obviously of someone who's extremely talented and deserved this very, very much. But I also felt it was a recognition for my generation, for the people who saw the importance of Bob Dylan. And I was just thrilled and excited and couldn't have been happier. From the very earliest times of me enjoying music, Bob Dylan was numero uno in my life. And I was just overjoyed. I remember when I was in college, there were teachers who wanted to teach courses on Bob Dylan,
yeah.
And the conservatives who were generally in charge of the universities or the departments in the universities were horrified by it. Just the whole notion of even considering it to be literature and anything other than, you know, some kind of, you know, pop song, was something that they were horrified by. And, that was just part of those tumultuous times, where there were people who recognized what Bob Dylan was and who he was, and then there were people who just, you know, could not see it for anything.
To our younger listeners, what is some essential Dylan that they should check out?
Well, I would recommend that they check out the earliest Dylan stuff, like the stuff primarily, you know, Blonde on Blonde album and before, you know, songs like Absolutely 6th Street or 4th Street, whatever street it was. It's just all the early Bob Dylan. Like and unfortunately, YouTube doesn't have a lot of Bob Dylan for some bizarre reason.
Vimeo does.
But always stuff coming and going. So if you go to YouTube, that's how you listen to your music, and you type in Bob Dylan, any of his early songs, would be the way to go. So anything from Blonde on Blonde and earlier.
You ran Warner Brothers Records and Reprise. He's always been with Columbia, right? So you
that is right.
You never did business with him.
I never did business with him at all. Or one of my neighbors played with him, and they're very close still to this day. Jim Keltner. And then the person on the other side of the fence from me, downslope, is one of his two or three best friends in the world. So I have some kind of connection through these people with him, but really not. We have mutual friends.
Does he have friends?
Sorry?
Does he have friends?
Absolutely has friends. And, and enemies. I mean, you know, someone who I have been very, very close with, has I wouldn't want to say an enemy situation with her, although sometimes it is an enemy situation, and she talks about him. But I always felt when she had nasty things to say about him, she also had a complete fondness for him as well. So it was two things at the same time. And I'm describing Joni Mitchell right now, who always seemed to be frustrated because people would always say she's the greatest female songwriter in the world, and that would drive her insane. It would literally drive her crazy because she considered herself to be the greatest songwriter in the world, not to be the greatest female songwriter in the world. And even, you know, where she, and even to a point where when someone would say that to her, she would wind up attacking Dylan.
Wow.
I'm going to see her tomorrow, and it'll be interesting to see what she says about this Nobel Prize.
I had no idea that, you know, humans are humans. That's really interesting.
Except for Trump.
We'll get to that in a second. His poetry, if you strip away the voice and the music, does the poetry stand on its own?
Well, to me, it always did. I mean, bear in mind, in the last years, I haven't been listening to Bob Dylan's music. I hear people saying that it's still good and his songs are still wonderful. But I went from being a Bob Dylan fanatic who would live my life by listening to Bob Dylan albums to being someone who I haven't heard his 10 last albums. So I couldn't say. But in terms of the question you're asking is whether or not his poetry stands up. To me, it does. It says something to me. It's important. It seems to me to be very, very important. And let's face it. I mean, Bob Dylan is not, you know, some guy that's got like some incredible voice. That's not what it is. Bob Dylan is not some kind of amazing, incredible musician in terms of how he plays his guitar or his harmonica. That's not what it's about. I mean, Bob Dylan is about his lyrics or his poems, however you want to say it. So
we'll move on to less important stuff. But was he the one who taught John Lennon that music is now about the entire sound, that you can't focus on lyrics or the music? You have to really focus on the sound of the song, the overall sound.
I don't know. I've never read that, so I have no idea.
Because that's what kind of happened in the 60s with the Beatles, where the music itself became less important than the sound. And so that's why I wonder about the poetry. But let's move on.
Okay.
Shall we?
Yes, we shall.
Okay. Tell me about Sugar. Debbie Wasserman Schultz, you write in Down with Tyranny, gets a couple $100,000 in donations from the sugar lobbyists in Florida.
Well, I mean, yes, she does. But there's much more to it than just the amount of money that Debbie Wasserman Schultz takes from sugar lobbyists and from sugar companies. In the United States, there's a sugar cartel. And so no matter what the company is called, there are a lot of different companies, they're all owned by one family. It's the Fungul family.
Yeah, let me interrupt. Can I interrupt you for a second? Let me just put this in context. Last week, President Obama lifted the embargo on rum and Cuban cigarettes.
Cuban rum and Cuban cigars.
And you need sugar to make rum. So we can now drink Cuban rum and Cuban cigars, and yet there's no embargo. They didn't lift the embargo on sugar, correct?
Right, and what you have to understand is that sugar is by far, and I mean by far, the biggest piece of the Cuban economy. So what they're looking for is not to sell a bunch of cigars or to sell some rum to tourists, but they're looking for a lifting of the sugar embargo. That's the big piece of the puzzle, and that's not happening. So the point in the piece that I wrote was that Debbie Wasserman Schultz, and not her alone, there were several others as well in the Senate, certainly Marco Rubio, in the House, Ileana Ross-Lehtinen and Mario Diaz-Balart, they're all in this together. They get large amounts of money from the sugar industry. And as I was saying, in this country, that's the Fungul family. That family owns the entire sugar production capacity of the United States, almost all of it. And they are, and it's not just the amounts of money, since you brought up Debbie Wasserman Schultz, it's not just the amounts of money that they've given her, which is very, very large, but It's the amount of money that they've spent on her career. They have guaranteed that she would become a powerful member of Congress. How do you do that? She was able to say to them, all right, these 30 Democratic freshmen, I can control them, give each of them $5,000. So that doesn't show up as a Debbie Wasserman Schultz contribution, but that's a gigantic contribution to her power. And that literally happened. What I just said actually did happen.
Well, that's how Lyndon Johnson became Senate Majority Leader, right?
Sorry?
That's how Lyndon Johnson became Senate Majority Leader.
He was good at that kind of stuff as well. That's right. But in the case of Debbie, when the head of the Appropriations Committee, Charlie Rangel at the time, brought up lifting the Cuban sugar embargo, this was many years ago, about a decade ago, and it was going to sail through. It was bipartisan. The Republicans were okay with it. The Democrats were okay with it. The leadership of both parties were good, and it was a go. And then the vote came, and all of a sudden, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, suddenly, out of nowhere, had enough votes to stop it. Hmm. And who are all of these freshman congressmen in 2006 who were going along with her on this? And then when you looked at it, they had all gotten large contributions from the Fonjules on the same day, and all at her direction. So when I say that she is in bed with the sugar industry, I'm not just talking about the hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars that they've given her and the independent expenditures. I mean, they said they would, if she was in trouble, for example, in this primary that she just had, they would finance $1 million advertising campaign in her favor. As it turned out, they gave quite a lot of money. They didn't have to give $1 million. She won her primary anyway. But that is the power of this sugar cartel, and that was why I contend that the sugar embargo was not lifted when Obama lifted the embargo on tobacco products, or at least on cigars. Tobacco is the number two agricultural product of Cuba, and when he lifted that, but not on sugar, and right. That's because powerful interests. As you and I had talked about earlier, back in around 1900, after the United States occupied, sort of fought a war with Spain and occupied Cuba, there was some talk about incorporating Cuba into the United States, in a similar way to the way Puerto Rico was incorporated into the United States. Puerto Rico is still not a state, but it's part of the United States. Cuba, they didn't want to do that with, because the sugar beet producers in the West had enough power, especially, believe it or not, in Minnesota. I think that was the main state that was producing sugar beets at the time, but also North Dakota was, Montana was, Wyoming was, but Idaho, those states were producing sugar beets, and they didn't want the competition of cheap sugar from Cuba coming in. And the history of Cuban sugar prices is incredible. I mean, it could go in less than a year from 2 cents a pound to 50 cents a pound. I mean, and people make their living on that. I mean, that's a gigantic disparity. And
what about Hawaii? Now, Hawaii is sugar cane. That's different than sugar beets, right?
Yeah, but at that time, that wasn't as big a factor. It became a big factor, but it's, I mean, sugar beets, sugar cane.
But then we did allow Hawaii to become a state, and did that have any effect on the price of sugar?
You know what? It probably did, but I don't know. When I just went back to research this, I researched the how it related to Cuba. I wasn't looking at Hawaii,
right?
So I don't know.
I was just thinking maybe North Dakota.
So Hawaii certainly didn't have any kind of political clout to prevent the U.S. from annexing Cuba. That they weren't even a state at the time.
I'm surprised that we allowed Hawaii to become a state, given the powerful lobby, the powerful sugar lobby, in the Dakotas.
Yeah, but Hawaii didn't become a state until what?
59, 58?
Yeah, I mean that's recent history. We're talking about in Cuba. That was half a century earlier.
Yeah, yeah. So it's interesting that sugar and tobacco, an argument could be made that sugar is more lethal than tobacco. That they're now finding that you need sugar in order to get cancer. And you also are discovering, I mean, it's almost just accepted, received wisdom now, that sugar makes people fat more than fat makes people fat. And all the
Sugar makes you obese. Sugar gives diabetes, cancer, heart disease. Sugar is responsible for a lot of the is at the base of a lot of the most lethal health problems that Americans face.
And the
absolute.
In fact,
the story that I did at the very end of it, I interviewed a physician named Alina Valdez, and Alina is running for Congress against one of Debbie Wasserman Schultz's Republican cronies, this guy Mario Diaz-Balart. And Diaz-Balart is in the same situation as Wasserman Schultz. He takes a lot of money from Big Sugar, and he is part of that bloc who prevents normalization of relations with Cuba. He doesn't want normalization. Ironically, his father, Diaz-Balart's not his father, his grandfather, I think it was his grandfather, was the Minister of the Interior under Batista, the fascist Castro overthrew in Cuba. And his father was his grandfather, was a hands-on torturer. And he and his brother became U.S. congressmen, and the brother resigned from Congress, or eventually didn't run, the older brother, Lincoln Diaz-Balart, and he is now preparing to become president of Cuba. He thinks that when the Castros are dead, he's going to go back there and the people will welcome him as their next president. So he left the U.S. Congress and is just spending all of his time and getting ready to be president of Cuba.
Wow. I want to get to WikiLeaks and the Orange Man, but the sugar lobby is so powerful that, you know, I came of age, I was convinced, in the 80s and the 90s, that the key to losing weight was by having a low-fat diet. Well, when you take out, that was the 80s and the 90s and the aughts, where they just said, get rid of the fat. You know, if you don't want to be fat, don't eat fat. Well, get rid of the fat, it has no taste, so you have to put sugar into it. So I consumed low-fat food that had a lot of sugar in it, and most Americans consumed low-fat food and bulked up on sugar. And throughout the 80s and the 90s, despite the fact that everybody was joining health clubs and working out and running, they kept gaining weight, and nobody could figure it out. And what they discovered was that by removing fat and replacing fat with sugar, it makes you obese. It makes you dead inside. And
now remember, when you're blaming this on the sugar lobby, it really is one family. It's not like some gigantic industry with lots and lots and lots of people. We're talking about one family, F-A-N-J-U-L, Fanjul. It's that family is the ones that we're talking about. And they are having this profound effect on the health of this country, and they are enabled by the politicians who they're bribing. But namely, right now, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, Marco Rubio, Mario Diaz-Balart, and Ileana Roth-Lehtinen. These four South Florida politicians.
And they bribe the scientific community. They bribed scientists into suppressing studies that show that sugar makes you fat and that fat doesn't make you fat.
What they do is they pay scientists, so-called, a lot of money to look at it from a different perspective. and to be able to cast doubt on it, the same way that the tobacco lobby once did, where they had some Americans believing that tobacco was healthy for you, that if you smoked tobacco, you would live longer. People actually thought that, and that was because the tobacco industry was able to,
right,
you know, have their own in-pocket scientists to say that, the same way that, for example, the oil companies are trying to cast doubt on the fact that there's such a thing as climate change influenced by man's activities on Earth. And they are doing their best to persuade, and they have persuaded a whole political party, the Republicans, that of that.
Yeah. We're going to get to WikiLeaks.
What are we going to do?
Yeah. I just want to mention there's a movie called Fed Up that Katie Couric narrated and produced with Larry David's ex-wife, Lori David. It's about sugar. It's about the subject. And one of the interesting areas that they discuss was during the 80s and the 90s, we were told to get rid of fat. So the dairy industry started making non-fat milk in bulk. And everything was get rid of the fat, get rid of the fat, get rid of the fat. Well, what do you do when you get rid of the fat? You have cheese. You have these vats of cheese left when you get rid of fat. So the dairy industry was left with cheese. And all of a sudden, according to this movie Fed Up, pizza took off. I mean, when I was younger in the 70s and the 60s, pizza was, okay, you know, I'll have a little, occasionally you would have a slice of pizza. But because—
Where are you from?
From New York, New Jersey.
I am too. We ate pizza all the time.
Not the way people are eating pizza now, according to the movie
really?
Fed Up. Yeah. That there became an epidemic of pizza in America, double cheese pizza, because the dairy industry was getting rid of fat from all the products and, you know, from the dairy products and making cheese. So they had to push cheese on the American people. And that's what fueled the pizza craze in America with double cheese, more cheese, cheese topping. That's from the movie.
You're making me hungry.
I know. Me too. I'm starving. By the way, I've given up sugar. I haven't had sugar in 2 months. And, I think I've lost a little weight. I have lost a little weight. Okay. Speaking of, people who don't lose weight, Donald Trump, this is the first time.
It'd be interesting that you should start off that way. Speaking of people who don't lose weight, because Donald Trump does lose weight. I want to tell you a story.
Okay.
This is kind of a long, and I want to say it right, so not to put your listeners to bed here, but a friend of mine works in the, let's call it the plastic surgery industry, and his company buys practices, plastic surgery practices, and one of the practices that they bought was Mark Foley's husband. I don't think they call it a husband, but it was Mark Foley's boyfriend.
So remind everybody who Mark Foley is.
Mark Foley was a congressman from Florida, a Republican congressman who was gay, who got caught having sex with teenage pages, underage boys. He never admitted that he did that. He said he just sent some nasty little or naughty little emails. But he has admitted to me that he did do that. He and I sat down and had dinner together, and he admitted that he was sleeping with these boys. He said he never slept with any that were underage because he would take them from state to state. So depending on how old they was, he wouldn't screw them unless he was in Virginia or West Virginia or Maryland, depending on how old they were, because each of those states has a different age of a consent. So that's what he told me, but I spoke to a boy who told me that Foley had sex with him here in California when he was 16, and the age of consent here is 18. So Foley was lying.
So he violated.
In any case,
but hang on for 1 second. He violated the Man-Boy Act, I believe. Now, now he was a Republican.
In any case,
hang on. He was a Republican congressman. This was in 2004, I believe. Or 2006.
He was a Republican congressman for a very long time. In 2006 is when this whole thing exploded.
And because of him.
And he resigned.
he resigned, and there was an epidemic of child molesters and gay predators in the Republican Party. And because of that, many say the Republicans lost the House. My question is, Dennis Hastert was the speaker at that time. Why? He was a wrestling coach. How come he didn't, put his fist down and stop that? Oh, right. I forgot. Okay, go ahead.
Dennis Hastert was also guilty of that.
Did everybody know that?
He was guilty of having sex with the pages. I don't know that. But he was having sex with young boys at the same time.
Did Tom DeLay really?
That's why he's in jail now.
Right. Tom DeLay was the brains, for lack of a better word, of the Republican House back then. Did he know Dennis Hastert?
Knew that Dennis Hastert was up to that.
So that's why he was made speaker, right? Because he could be controlled. He had a secret, right?
And he, for a very long time, he protected Foley. Foley was also an alcoholic, and he wanted to get out, and they would convince him, don't get out, because they were nervous that they would lose that seat if he left. So they persuaded him to stay in the House, even when he realized that it was a dangerous thing for everybody concerned. And I mean, he's a smart guy. He knew that he couldn't control himself. He would get drunk and, go looking for boys in the Page dormitory, which is absolutely forbidden.
So it was
the Republican Party at the time. But we're so off the topic.
I know, but I want to make a larger point, and then we'll get back to it. The point I want to get to is Dennis Hastert was Speaker of the House. He was the Republican Speaker of the House. It's the most powerful position in Washington, D.C. You control the purse strings, right? But he had zero power because he was a child molester, and Tom DeLay knew that he was a child molester, so he was just a puppet. He could be controlled. They wanted a very weak, vulnerable guy with a secret, a dirty, dark secret, to look like he was running the House, when in fact he was a sinecure, right?
I don't know if sinecure is the right word, but what you're getting at is the right word.
Okay.
Is the right thing.
All
yes.
Right. Mark Foley. Back to Mark Foley.
Yes. So Foley's significant other he died recently, the plastic surgeon to the stars. He was not just some random plastic surgeon. He was big time. His people would come from all over the wealthy people would come from all over the world, because he didn't make people look like these messes that you see sometimes with women who have, lips that are go from their nose to their chin, and people with, all sorts of deformities. He was an artist, and he happens to be he's in Palm Beach. Oh, he was in Palm Beach, and he was Trump's, cosmetic surgeon. And so anyway, when my friend's company bought his practice, my friend happened to stumble upon Trump's records, and he explained to me some of the procedures that Trump was getting there, which included something that I'd never heard of called the Venus freeze, that Trump was getting that to control his weight. He also was getting, Botox every 8 months, et cetera. So in any case,
I heard,
because you suddenly started talking about Trump and fat, and that triggered that thought in me about how Trump is a big fat, obese guy who eats horribly. He's just into fast food, and he controls that by artificially, by getting this Venus freeze and getting these various kinds, lots and lots of different procedures to help him look more presentable and younger.
I heard they take fat from his ass and inject it into his brain. Was that in the file?
If it was in the file, my friend didn't mention it to me.
Okay. And yet, Newt Gingrich, who's fat, morbidly obese, and Donald Trump, who's morbidly obese, make fun of women for being fat. Talk about the pot calling the kettle the N-word. anyway.
Right. Well, I mean, I've always thought that when it comes to Donald Trump, the main dynamic of his psychology that comes through the clearest is projection. So, in other words, anything that he's thinking about himself, he accuses his rivals of those things. When he would call, you know, Cruz Lion Ted, there's no one who's, I mean, yes, maybe Cruz is a liar, but there's no one that comes close to being as much a liar as Donald Trump, ever. I mean, he's the biggest liar that American politics has ever seen. You can count on almost anything that comes out of his mouth as being a lie.
Who do you hate more, Romney or Trump?
Romney or Trump?
Yeah.
I don't hate Romney.
Okay. Do you hate Trump?
Do I hate Trump? Not really. I hate what I see him doing to the country. That I hate.
Isn't he? Isn't he boiling off the wretched refuse, the deplorables from the Republican Party?
Is he boiling them off? I don't know what you mean by boiling them off. He's making the whole thing worse.
Well, he's kind of like exposing the worst of the worst. And
they're all very heavily armed, by the way. These deplorables we're talking about. I mean, today the sheriff of Milwaukee County, for example, was intimating that after the election is stolen by Hillary, we're going to have to do something about it. And the intimation was revolution. This is the sheriff of a huge important county. So, guess what? The police unions have all endorsed Trump. So, it's pretty scary when you think about it, that the country is in some real problem right there.
I kind of mean this because I'm living in the safety of Manhattan. So I'm saying this because I like to think I'm not vulnerable. But isn't this good? We know where they are now. We know who the
No, it isn't good.
We know who the wackos are.
But the wackos, how about if they start shooting? You know, they got them in Suffolk County as well.
That's
no,
true.
It's not good. And the last thing we need is any kind of a civil war. And when you listen to Trump, it sounds like he's trying to gin that up a little bit. These people that he talks to, these are people whose brains are defective from listening to hate talk radio and Fox News for decades, for commuting in their cars in the morning and getting all riled up and filled with hatred and insanity. Half the people in the country, by definition, have two-digit IQs, and half the people have three-digit IQs. And someone who's got, 100 IQ or 110 IQ isn't Einstein, but someone who's got an 80 IQ doesn't have the capacity to understand abstracts. So Trump's followers, not all of Trump's followers, but many of Trump's followers are very stupid, brainwashed people. Sorry to say it. So not just ignorant, but actually stupid.
You know, I want to have.
But they can shoot. They have guns. They have. Do you? I bet you don't have a gun.
I don't want anybody to know the answer to that question.
Okay, well, fine. But I'll still bet it. In any case, the last thing we need is a civil war. The last thing we need is someone to say, let's hunt down all the intolerables and do something to them. I mean, I was frightened the other day listening to Keith Olbermann talking about they should all be made to go back to second grade and start over again.
What do you mean back?
Well,
what do you mean back? Forward to second grade.
Yeah, right. The point is, you know, you can't force anybody to do anything. You can't force them back to go to second grade. It would be great if they did it voluntarily, but they're not going to.
Yeah, it's pretty, I don't know. It's, I don't know. There's a part of me that gets terrified that, I kind of think he's not going to win. I'm almost convinced he's not going to win. there's a part of me that thinks he's doing this country a favor by, you know, you got to hit rock bottom. And maybe there's more to, there's further to drop. But I mean, if I'd like to think, I saw the New York Times, the New York Times did a little 10-minute documentary where they went to the Eric Erickson's organization, Red State Convention.
Yeah.
You know, Eric Erickson, the right wing. And these are conservatives who've abandoned Trump. It's Glenn Beck, Eric Erickson, and some other less famous conservatives. All of them are on the verge of tears. All of them are at least claiming to be introspective, wondering what caused this. All of them are on the verge of tears, talking about the death threats that they have received from Trump supporters for abandoning him. And they've looked into the abyss of their own soul, their own party, and claim they realize now that something is gravely wrong and they need to reach across the aisle and have conversations and start listening. I don't believe a word of it. I mean, I heard Glenn Beck talking this way and Eric Erickson talking this way. They are really scared. But you know what? As the cliche, this is, they created this Frankenstein.
They did. But, you know, Eric Erickson's family has been threatened to the point where he now has 24-hour bodyguards because of his young children and his wife.
But isn't Eric Erickson?
It's people, armed people coming to his house.
But isn't he guilty of being a rabid conservative? 4 years ago, was it? He is no moderate, right?
That's right.
He ginned up. He revved up. Glenn Beck.
But they don't think that Trump is part of their movement. They don't see Trump as being, he's not a conservative. Is Trump a conservative?
But what I'm saying is, didn't they play to the same, didn't Glenn Beck and Eric Erickson play to the very same people Trump is appealing to, using the same tactics, spreading the same lies?
Yes, stupid people. That's who they appeal to, stupid people.
So I don't want anybody hurt, but doesn't Eric Erickson deserve what's happening to him? Shouldn't he be scared? Isn't this?
He doesn't deserve it. No one deserves to have their family threatened. I mean, it's not, like I said, he's not getting emails saying we're mad at you, we're going to hurt you. That's not what's happening. People with guns are coming to his home telling his wife to kill her. He doesn't deserve that. No one does.
Okay. Is he a big supporter of the NRA?
I don't know for a fact that he is, but if I had to guess, I would say yes.
Okay. I agree with you. I don't want anybody threatened and nobody's family threatened. But I do know that Glenn Beck and Eric Erickson, who are featured prominently in this New York Times 10-minute documentary, I remember them 4 years ago, and I remember how crass and angry they were, and how especially Glenn Beck manipulating the truth and lying and calling Obama a racist who hates white people, calling him a scumbag. Glenn Beck called President Obama a scumbag and really incited insurrection.
You're right. Absolutely.
So
they're bad people.
They are bad people.
And they let loose forces that they didn't. They think of themselves as, you know, constitutional conservatives. Their idea of a constitutional conservative is someone like Ted Cruz. And they didn't realize the strength of the id that they were uncovering was going to throw up or puke out Donald Trump, which is what's happened.
Right. They've been cuckolded by Donald Trump. Donald Trump is stupping the stupid, unwashed masses instead of them. And, I have to say, in 1 year, Donald Trump destroyed two Bushes. Billy Bush and Jeb Bush. And if he doesn't get elected, I don't know. I think he's been a gift to this country. I think. Are you voting for Jill Stein?
Yes.
You are?
If I lived in Ohio, or if I lived in Florida, if I lived in Iowa, I know that I would vote for Hillary Clinton. But I live in California. I'm voting for Jill Stein.
That's a big statement for you, because in the past, you said you were no longer voting for the lesser of two evils. I mean, you are voting for Jill Stein, but for you to say that if I lived in Ohio or Florida...
Yes. Because it's beyond lesser of two evils at this point. He's such a greater evil that it's beyond evil. He's an existential threat to the United States.
And when did you decide that?
Over the course of the last couple of months.
Okay. Before you go, you always have the information before anybody else does. When are we going to have a woman come forward and say she was raped by Donald Trump?
Oh, well, I don't have that information, and I don't know if it's going to happen. People are afraid of him. I mean, there are 9 women that have come forward, one of whom is leaving the country with her family because of the level of threats. But the 9 women represent a tiny tip of the iceberg of the numbers of women who have gone and said that they won't come forward and identify themselves, that have gone to the media. Some of these reporters are saying they've spoken, you know, they get one woman who's willing to come forward, and they've had a dozen women who they'll talk to them off the record, but they won't give their names. Has he raped anybody?
Okay, I'm going to ask you.
I don't know that for a fact. There's one woman who said that she was, I think, 15, and he raped her. And there's an ongoing suit which the judge has put off until December. The court case won't be until December. So there is a rape case already.
Yeah, the thing, you know, we're going to wrap it up, but the thing we need to remember is when you... I don't mean to equate Bob Dylan with Donald Trump, but we were talking about Bob Dylan at the beginning.
Yes.
You cannot project, you talked about projection earlier, your own goodness or your own lifestyle onto other people. In other words, you cannot even begin to imagine the way Bob Dylan lives. And you cannot project or imagine the way Donald Trump lives or the way he thinks. They're not human. Donald Trump is not a human being. And he doesn't think like a normal human being because he's not a human being. And
well, David, he is a human being. I don't like him. I probably don't like him more than you don't like him, but he's a human being.
The
Woody Guthrie song that was recently discovered about the apartment complex that his father had, and that where they would, if black people or Puerto Rican people would come to rent, they would put a C for colored on the application so they wouldn't rent to them.
I thought it was classified.
And then Woody Guthrie lived there, and Woody Guthrie wrote a song about it.
Mm-hmm.
In the day. Well, my first girlfriend lived in that neighborhood as well. And the Trumps were very, very well known in that neighborhood. I was just a kid. I was not even a teenager. And I knew of the Trump family. And so I do feel like, I know them in a way. And they're not as distant as you would expect, you know, some like billionaires to be. They were much more sort of down to earth. I'm not saying anything good about them. I'm not complimenting them in any way right now, but I'm telling you that my impression is that they weren't this high and mighty, thing the way I'll bet that Barron Trump is, the 10-year-old kid. Now he's being raised, he's got somebody who dresses him, and he's 10 years old, he's got a secretary, he's got a whole staff of his own, and his own quite large, apartment on his own with a staff. So what you're describing, that would fit Barron. I don't think it fits Donald Trump. I think Donald Trump is a fat slob from Brooklyn and Queens who, you know, eats shitty food and has a lot of the same kind of way of looking at life as a lot of other people that we know do, who are from that time and that place. I don't think, you know, he's extremely cheap. I mean, Donald Trump.
Especially with his barber.
He reminds me a lot of I don't want to name who it is, but one of my old bosses, who's also fabulously rich, but I literally saw him fighting a bum in the street over a dime that he dropped. He was rolling around on the street. This is a guy that's got tens of millions of dollars. And he dropped a dime, and the bum grabbed the dime, and my former boss jumped on him and started fighting him. That's the kind of guy that Donald Trump is as well.
You know what? You know what makes me really happy, Howie? You are a brilliant man, a great writer, a progressive, a liberal. You're politically correct, but you still call them bums.
I know. When I said that, I was thinking, "Oops, I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have thought that. That's a horrible thing to, a horrible way to talk about another human being." I actually, as it was coming out of my mouth, I was thinking the same thing.
We all, you know, all of us are guilty of something, but you weren't caught on tape talking about grabbing a woman's pee. Word.
Are you not allowed to say that on the station?
No, not on the station.
That's funny because they at MSNBC they weren't saying it for the whole week, the whole first week. No one was allowed to say the word, and then all of a sudden they just gave up, and now everyone is saying it.
Yeah, it's like during the Clinton impeachment, we finally got to say blowjob. You weren't allowed to say blowjob, and you're not allowed to say it anymore, apparently.
So here we have Donald Trump just coarsening the discourse of the entire country.
Yeah. Well, okay. This is the first time we started the interview without you going, "I don't want to talk about Donald Trump." Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. Go to it, and if you give money, that money will be given to progressive candidates around the country. He's also author of the Down with Tyranny blog, which you should all read every day. And I look forward to talking to you again, sir.
Me too. When I'm not on for a few weeks, I get all these complaints as though it's like my fault.
Yeah, I know. It's my fault. It's my fault.
Thank you. But, you know, you listen to the thing, it's my fault, and they yell at me.
Okay. Well, we'll talk to you next week.
All right. Bye-bye, David.
Thank you. That's our show. I want to thank Howie Klein, as always, for stopping by. And make sure to go to Down with Tyranny. Read him every day. He knows everything. Friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see an Amazon banner. Click on it. Doesn't cost you more to shop on Amazon. Support our sponsors. Give us a good review on iTunes. It helps. And I answer all my emails from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us. I'm going to tell you about a podcast that I listen to. Two of my friends host it, and I think you should listen to it. Andrew Goldstein, maybe you remember him as my Jew on some of our more popular episodes of the David Feldman Show. Andrew Goldstein is a brilliant comedy writer from MTV and Race Wars. And Matt Goldich writes for Late Night with Seth Meyers, brilliantly funny comedian and comedy writer. They have a new podcast. You can download it on iTunes. It's called Sorry, I've Been So Busy. You know, everyone always says they're so busy, but what exactly are they so busy with? Well, in their podcast, Sorry I've Been So Busy, writer-comedians Matt Goldich and Andrew Goldstein talk to their interesting and funny friends to find out what they've actually been so busy with. Everything from major life and career events to everyday minutiae. Sorry I've Been So Busy is the only podcast that will never blow you off unless something comes up.